Welcome to Prose and Cons, a podcast by writers for writers, brought to you by Precipice Fiction. Precipice Fiction would like to acknowledge the people of the Eora and Durag nations as the original custodians and storytellers of the land this podcast was created on.
All right. Hello, listeners. Welcome to the Pros and Cons Precipice Fiction podcast. Today, I'm James Healy. Well, I'm James Healy every day, but today I'm
today, you're especially James Healy.
particularly James Healy today, and I'll be hosting. And joining me is Ali Burnham.
Hello.
Alex Eldridge.
Hiya.
Phoenix Ray.
Hello.
And Paddy Boylan.
Oh, man. Oh,
sorry, James. I drew the four of them and I was like, yes. And then I was like, oh, it just says it at the corner.
I noticed that you skipped Ali and went to Alex. That's why. I forgot my name, you son of a bitch.
Oh, I skipped Ali because she was still laughing.
I'll forgive you one day.
My bad. And today we'll be talking about horror. But before we jump into that, I would just like to ask everyone, what are you all reading at the moment? What have you been consuming? What have you been watching this week? Paddy?
It's not going to make up for it.
that ship has sailed, James.
Yeah, not a whole lot at the moment. I'm actually watching a documentary series right now, but it's probably not that on topic, so I won't get into it. So yeah, not a lot. Pass. All right.
How about yourself, Phoenix?
It's just been more of the same, like continuing Downton Abbey, continuing Lord of the Rings, continuing Harry Potter, the Italian one, and then the only like kind of new thing, I may have mentioned it last week, was we also started rewatching Altered Carbon, and yeah, some little things have been jumping out at me this time that I didn't. I don't know. I'm just kind of watching their world building because they do it very fast. And I think they do a very good job of it.
Nice. Alex, what are you reading this week?
I've been reading, it's called Vile Bodies by Evelyn Waugh. It's kind of just a satire of 1930s, like the Bright Young Things era, like just a bunch of people coming out of World War One being like, oh, we're terribly debaucherous and we'd like to have parties and things. And the older generation are like, well, I didn't know about this at all. But it's really good. I've read through the whole thing and I'm like, you know what? I feel like I could have got more out of that. I'm going to read it again. So I've just, I've audiobooked it and I've been going through that. But that's been really good. Really good to see like a combination of like just absurdist satire and then like kind of serious undertones of like, oh no, but there's a war going on. You know. So that's good. I really recommend it.
And for me, I can mention The White Whale again. I'm getting through it. I imagine it's quite an infamous scene where he puts his hands into the actual like sperm whale oil and has like a religious experience. And it's actually like one of my favorite paragraphs because it's just nonstop talk about squeezing the sperm. So obviously there's that level of entertainment, but then also it's also just a genuinely well-written just section. And so I can't wait to come back to that.
Yeah, no, it's really
pun intended. And otherwise, in terms of new media, I've been watching Moon Knight on Disney, which is interesting. It kind of ties into today's topic in that it does have horror elements. Obviously, it's balancing its comedy with the horror because it's Marvel. But it is walking into horror tropes and creating some genuinely like creepy, unsettling moments. They're doing a really good job. The last episode I watched had like it is basically a mummy, the monster, where it's harvesting the body in front of them while they're trying to hide in the room. And it's actually quite grotesque in a good way and tense.
That sounds good. I might check that out.
What's it called?
Moon Knight.
Moon Knight, right.
Yeah. Good on them for using a mummy. I feel like that's an underused monster in the last like number of years.
True.
Oh yeah, it's having all the fun with its like Egyptian tropes, the Indiana Jones stuff. So it's in conversation with all that as well, but on the slightly more horror end of that scale, which is an interesting choice because they could have gone the more rompy side, but they haven't.
Yeah, but stuff like pulling the brain out through the nose. I mean, that's ripe horror right there.
Yeah, yeah.
Ooh. Yeah.
Mummies might make a comeback. Might be like the next Twilight.
I got better the more I thought about it.
We need to sexual. We need to sexualize mummies more.
We have to get in there.
Bring
first.
Them more into the zeitgeist.
Sexy monster. Them and Frankenstein, man. They're the big ones. The big sexy boys.
Yeah. All the cadavers.
All right. So I guess we'll jump into our team, and I wanted to start by asking everyone what draws everyone to horror. What is it that why do each of you read horror? What do you think people are drawn towards reading horror?
Well, I think that horror, because I kind of wonder why it's sort of my favorite genre of book or film or whatever, particularly books. But I think it's just when I really get down to it, horror is a kind of it's a very strong emotion. Fear is a very strong emotion, and it's sort of. It just takes you back to like a primal level. Like it's very stimulating. It's just very like, this is spooky. This is making me feel something. So I think it's just that. It's like that. It's your brain going like, hey, this is bad. You should pay attention to this. And just that stimulation itself is just like, you know, I think that's a big part of it.
I've never read any horror. I've read one short story of Stephen King's due to Alex pushing me to do so, and it was wonderful, but I've never really read horror in any depth, and I'm not a massive consumer of horror, but when I do watch it, what I like is less being scared and more the feeling of being profoundly unsettled. I really like that feeling of the uncanny and the strange when, like, for example, one of my favorite films is, I don't know if you call it The Witch or The Witch, it's spelled with two V's, set in New England, about like kind of a witch in the forest story, but really dark and unsettling. And it just leaves you feeling like kind of strange and uneasy, which that's one of the feelings I love from science fiction as well. The feeling of being just left in a weird place where you don't know what the rules are. And yeah, it's troubling without being frightening. But I've never read any horror and I should.
I'm similar. I'm kind of, I don't dive as deeply into horror, but intellectually I love the idea of horror and I would advocate for it as a genre for children and YA audiences specifically. I love the idea that what horror does is create this safe space to explore negative and uncomfortable emotions. It's almost like training wheels for young adults to experience these emotions in a controlled way before they have to like non-consensually experience those emotions later in life. And I love that as an exercise, and I love that as a genre.
For me, it's always just felt like I don't know, something in my gut attracts me to it. Even though I don't write a whole lot of it, I have a really great time every time I do, because it just feels fun to, like, it just feels like a fun writing prompt. It's like, I don't need any specific details, but just like, okay, in this moment, create an environment of tension, create an environment of suspense and fear, and see if I can, I just like the exercise of putting myself there and like to try to feel it in my gut. It's just like a fun, it's fun. And actually, I remembered like the very first time that I tried writing, like on a computer, where someone like, where my brother showed me an open Word document, and he was like, hey, you could just type. I'm like, no way. Like, that's crazy. And like, I went to my friend's house and they were like, all right, we were like six or seven. We're like, we're going to write on the computer in this room. You can use the computer in this room and we're going to write. And the first thing I wrote was, I tried to write horror, and it was something I'd never read. It wasn't even like that. It was like hardly in my house even, but that's what I was attracted to. But yeah, Ellie, what you were saying about like horror in YA, that was something that Neil Gaiman really set out to do with like Coraline, because he was saying he used to love like horror in children's books, and not enough children's books portray horror. And he was saying he felt like horror had a prevalent role to play in children's books to expose them to that. And it can be playful. It's not something that should be absent from a childhood. So yeah, he really was, with Coraline, trying to write horror for children.
You know, I feel like horror needs to elicit emotion, right? Like if horror doesn't elicit emotion, it's kind of failed. I feel like it almost has something in common with comedy in that way.
Yeah.
Both horror and comedy, if you're not making someone feel that very immediate reaction, it's probably not, you're probably not writing the genre. I guess all writing like needs to make you feel an emotion in some way, but not as much as those two, maybe.
Has harder rails.
Yeah, that's it. There's a benchmark that you can fail to hit.
I see horror is very similar to tragedy in that respect, that they kind of have to set up the same thing and they kind of land in the same place, very much so.
Yeah, the setup I think is really poignant though.
Yeah, that kind of brings me to my first little spiel, which is that I wanted to kind of jump into something which makes a horror story kind of very different from most other stories. And this is something which comes in the setup. This is called The Warning. Anyone who is, so I'm going to be kind of lame and read off my notes. it's a really good element for anyone to figure out who wants to write a scene with tension or a scene with dread. But in particular for horror writers trying to set up a good story, a good horror story. What the technique is, start that again. Oh, I'm blaming the brain fog. So it's just an important element to figure out if you want to write any good dread or any good suspense in a scene, but particularly for horror writers in setting up their story. They need to get a hang of the scene called The Warning. Anyone who's familiar with the hero's journey is familiar with the call to arms, which is essentially the point of the story where the hero is offered the opportunity to come and take the adventure. In a horror story, this is replaced or reversed with the warning, where the hero is either explicitly told by another character not to take the path that they're taking, or something slightly more subtle happens that kind of signposts to the reader that the character is about to make a mistake, but that the character either misses or ignores for some reason. And this can be particularly effective if it also kind of hints and indicates at like the final horror, the end state, or the monster later on in the story. This doesn't necessarily have to be something that takes place in a horror story. You can have this in kind of any scene, any romantic story where there's maybe a point where the characters might make a move that kind of causes them to break up, or even adventure stories where characters are kind of given a moral decision and one of the decisions is wrong and they're trying to think about whether or not they should take it. If someone indicates the consequences of what happens if you pick the bad option and then they take it anyway, that's kind of setting up elements of dread and elements of horror, which can like really praise the suspense in a story. This doesn't have to always be an explicit warning from one character to another. It could be something very subtle that's in the environment that kind of just indicates to the reader that the character is about to make a mistake. I'm kind of repeating myself. So that's basically it. This is my favorite part of a horror story because it's kind of the foundation for what sets up all the scares later to come. When it's done well, it gets the reader in a place where they're already looking out for signs and looking out for warnings and getting kind of nervous about stuff. What I wanted to do was just jump back to everybody and ask, can you think of any good scenes in horror films or in other type of stories where someone was given a warning or there was some kind of indication that maybe they were making a mistake? One of my favorite ones is the fight scene in Game of Thrones between the monster and or the mountain and the viper, where in the build-up to that scene, there's a bunch of people saying, like, are you sure you should be drinking right now? And are you sure you're wearing enough armor? And they keep kind of making suggestions that he's going to make a mistake. And he's just very, very, very confident. And this kind of set your tension going pretty, pretty well. Like,
I think about that scene at least once a week. Seriously. Yeah, you're absolutely right.
This isn't like... This was a warning in a rom-com that I watched last night. And it wasn't even like a warning that particularly made me feel a sense of dread or like anything. But the reason I'm bringing it up is it was just very evidently a warning. And like, and I really like, I saw it coming. It was an Italian movie. So I was also just kind of excited that I was understanding and picked up on the warning. I was like, oh, that's a warning right there. Here we go. Like something's going to happen, but they're just telling the character, like she had a birth defect where she had trouble breathing and her lungs were very sensitive. And the doctor was like, no, you're doing very well. Just, stay out of humid environments and stuff like that. And you should be fine. And I was like, oh, humid environments. I'm watching out for it. And sure enough, next scene, I see like mist in the air. I'm like, here it comes. We're going to get a coughing fit.
Yeah, a famous kind of trope of the warning sign is actually just the car driving down the road, and then the camera sort of pans out to like a sign that's been covered over with like trees and stuff that just says like the road is out. Or like,
I would love that if it was just one time that the car goes past it and pans over and it's just a tree obscuring like a stop sign.
Yeah.
It's just like, oh, they ran our stop sign. I guess nothing, there is no repercussion for that, but I guess we need to know that. I don't know if they didn't stop.
It draws my attention to something as well. Like in horror, you often need this logistical thing to make sure, like if you're in a bad situation, you're probably going to want to leave. Like that's, so in horror, there's this really common thing. It's almost ubiquitous where it's like, why are we stuck here? Why didn't we just walk over there? And there's always something like the vehicles are broken down. They're a long way away from home. And those things themselves can also almost be warnings. It's like you're going and it's like, oh, it's so great to get up to this isolated chalet for the weekend where no one can, you know, contact us in any way. What a great time, you know? So like that in itself can be a logistical setup and also a warning, but I guess it's less of like, I'm feeling a little bit like I might kill a bunch of people, you know, like that. You know, obviously that's an exaggeration, but
feeling a bit stabby today.
Yeah, I'm definitely feeling a little, you know, might put some cyanide in your tea. I don't know. It's just that sort of day.
I love that about like kind of the logistical, like the fact that they get trapped eventually. When you kind of take a look at like the hero's journey and you kind of try to reverse it a little bit for a horror story. Because in both versions of the hero's journey and the horror story, the warning or the call to arms is followed by a refusal of some kind. The character just goes ahead and does the thing anyway. And then you've got that mentor moment where you realize, oh, something is about to happen. And then the commitment is usually them getting trapped. And now they're kind of not able to get out of it. But it's after they realized, oh, we should leave. And they turn around and like, oh, the cars are gone or the horses have run away or whatever. Something I really like, just like you said about like the logistical setups of it.
Yeah, no, totally. Like, I mean, the classic one I can think of is The Shining, where like they're suddenly like, oh, it's a snowstorm. Oh no. And then, but the warning part of that is so basically the idea is someone comes in and like a whole family goes up to this hotel called the Overlook Hotel. And essentially just kind of, they're there as caretakers. And what happens is at one point, there's a big snowstorm and then the main character who, spoiler, like goes crazy and tries to kill everyone else, actually smashes the CB radio. And I think I forget exactly how it goes. I think it's framed as an accident or something. He frames it to the family, but I think he's just like, what if you just broke it? Like, and that's the point where we're like, oh, okay, this is maybe not good.
I just want to ask a quick question because I'm genuinely curious because I am kind of new to all the horror craft stuff and I'm interested in the relationship between red herrings and warnings. And I'm thinking specifically of something I'm struggling to write at the moment where I had a character is like giving breakfast to another character constantly every morning. And she's kind of like, here's my homebrew tonic. I want you to drink it. And how it ultimately ties into the themes is it's about like biocontrol when someone's, you know, controlling your whole life to that small extent, forcing you to drink this thing. But I've had beta reader responses being like, oh, I thought that was setting up like a poison that was going to eventually like be something in the end. So I realized it was like a setup problem. Maybe I was leaning on it too much. So I ripped it out of that draft. And then I had beta readers being like, oh, I did actually enjoy having the tonic though, because it was adding suspense. It made me uneasy. It made me question things. So I'm trying to find that fine line between introducing something that is, you know, unsettling, but it's not going to be part of the plot. It is just something that's going to keep adding to the atmosphere almost.
Yeah.
Is that a red herring or like a precursor though? Because in my mind, I'm not an expert on horror, but like a red herring is almost something that is falsely disarming. It's a boy who cries wolf, where you have a red herring and the audience is going, okay, it's not scary after all. So when the scary thing happens, they've been lulled into thinking, no, it's just going to diffuse.
Yeah, I think the reason I'm calling it a red herring, this specific example, is because a part of the mystery is like what's causing these things to happen. So I think readers were latching on to, oh, maybe it's a drug. So it was like an explanation in their mind they had latched onto, and then it never then obviously that wasn't the payoff. So there was a disappointment there I was trying to hedge. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, also, it would be nice to keep it because it was creating some kind of tension.
Mm. Well, I mean, was it creating a tension in terms of those two persons' relationship? Like, was that, without having read it, like, was that kind of the crux of the thing? Like, the way that this person was controlling this other person, and that just happened to be something that wasn't directly related to it, but it is indicative of their relationship as a whole?
Yeah, you're right. The solution might need to be more of a character thing and making sure I'm not flagging it as a plot thing, because that's where the audience might be disappointed. But if it is part of the, I'm controlling your breakfast, the atmosphere is getting more and more claustrophobic, I think that's where it's beneficial and not a detriment to the story.
Yeah, a big help as well in kind of trying to get the reader to tink along certain lines if you don't want the character to be figuring things out. It's to sort of have the character almost speculate about what could be happening, or maybe have them like overhear a conversation, because there's almost a technique of like getting information across to the reader that primes the reader to think a certain way that maybe the character isn't privy to, or maybe the character doesn't pick up on. You'd have the character, it is a drug that they're using, or it's that they're just controlling what they're eating for breakfast.
It's not a drug. It was almost like I was trying to have my cake and eat it too, in that I did leave it open to be like, is it a drug? But then I obviously that plot doesn't go anywhere. But then I realized by trying to create that question, I had set up a plot hole, literally. Yeah. But I still want to find a way to maintain the suspense without accidentally setting up a plot promise.
Yeah, that's a tricky one. Yeah, because you're.
But what you're saying, James, I do love what I'm discovering the more I try and tinker in horror, is that I feel like I'm more aware of the audience every step of the way, almost than any other genre. I'm trying to be aware of how I can handhold them through every moment and how I want them poised at every moment. And no, I kind of love, I'll just go on a little side spiel about what I love about horror. This idea that it is this consensual medium, that someone picks up the story or they buys a ticket to the movie because they want to experience that certain emotions, the adrenaline. But with my beta readers, I'm finding that there's a difference between a scene that makes them uncomfortable in a good way and a scene that makes them uncomfortable in a bad way, in that a scene has fulfilled the promise and they're happy and they're like, oh, I really enjoyed being uncomfortable there. But then they'll flag other scenes with me and be like, oh, that was the bad kind of discomfort. I was either it was too icky or it wasn't great, or I was thrown out of the world. Just another small example was I have a scene where a woman who is not capable of breastfeeding attempts to breastfeed a baby. So obviously I'm trying to create discomfort, but I've had readers react to that scene being like, oh no, that's too far. That was bad discomfort I had reading that. And I'm like, oh, more so than like the lamb blood scene. And they're like, oh yeah, the lamb blood scene fucking rocked, keep that in. But the breastfeeding scene was, so it's this fun intellectual exercise of unpacking that, being like, why was that a non-consensual discomfort? And how can I go and fix my setup so they're handheld all the way to that scene, so they are primed for that discomfort, invited into that discomfort in the right way? And I find that endlessly fascinating.
Yeah, that is an interesting one. I'm trying to think of how would you set up that kind of scene? What are the tones that you want to put into the story to get there? Yeah.
Well, it's back to the warnings. I love, so warnings is a new craft word for me this morning, hearing you talking about it. I love it. So the idea that I'm already thinking about how can I make that more central to the warnings I'm going to set up, that it is going to foreshadow this scene correctly. So when people get it, they're like, I knew that bad thing was going to happen. Oh God, and we're here, rather than just this really alarming scene that comes out of nowhere and makes people feel icky rather than good upset.
definitely some previous mention of that person or some kind of behavior surrounding that would get that dread of like, oh, sure, I hope they don't do something, and then it comes to it anyway. Yeah, because that's like some of the, because as you said, you've got that scene which is like, if we call it a horror scene, that is like the uncomfortable scene. But if you set up the foreshadowing in between both of those places, you've got all of the dread that builds up to it and the discomfort, which is where an awful lot of that horror magic is.
Yeah, and I think that's what I got to get better at. Yeah. Mm.
Yeah, it's a hard thing to do, to set up those like tiers of, what did I call it for? I called it something really good in like in the pre
rising thing.
It's
tension. Like,
what's you that? Call them the
rising tension.
Yeah, it's rising tension, but there's like these different tiers of alarm.
It's like hierarchy of alarm.
That's what I'm
yeah.
I'm trademarking that, so I'm going to sue you if anyone uses that. No, but like the hierarchy of alarm. So the idea of like there are these set points, these warnings that come in, and they have to be rising in tension, and they have to start off very innocuous, and they have to get more and more serious. But as we were talking about before with the logistics of leaving the place, because at some point the people are going to be like, okay, we need to be out. You have to make it so such that those hierarchies of alarm only crest at a point that is after they've been sealed in for whatever reason. So it's this very delicate balance of being like, I need to make sure you don't get too alarmed, so you know freak out and leave. But you know, you can't have it just teeter along like that, because otherwise the audience are going to get bored. So it's this very specific thing of doing that and enacting that so that the audience is handheld, but also the characters are not put off to the fact that they're like, I'm gonna bail, you know. And that's really, really, I've really struggled doing that in the book that I'm writing now, which is pretty much that. Like, they get stuck in a like basically a haunted house in the Blue Mountains, and they have to sort of figure out a way out. But it is difficult to do that without sort of crossing that boundary there. And there are a few liberties you can take with horror as well, because it's sort of magical. So you can just be like, that just happened because, like, which is one of the great things about horror. But it's difficult. It's difficult to make it convincing.
Yeah, there is a real balancing act with horror where you're trying to put something in and then not go too far, and put something in and not go too far. What were you going to say, Phoenix?
Back to Ali, what you were saying, it reminded me of a couple of weeks ago when we were talking about like choreography and sex scenes and stuff. And just like basically it becomes pornographic if you forget your characters and just start becoming, using things that aren't earned, have no place in the actual scene, have nothing to do with the plot, have nothing to do with the characters. And I was just thinking about that with the unsettling scene of the breastfeeding, because it sounds very, I was trying to think of like what might be the thing, but like, because it sounds very innately character driven and it sounds very intimate. And it sounds like a type of thing that would involve a lot of character and be very like set up very well in that way. So I was thinking like it was kind of already touched on, but like it would come down to like tone setup. Like it would be, has this tone maintained a theme throughout so that it makes sense being here now? And like, has the tension of this string been strung throughout so that it makes sense that we're here?
I think it is a tension thing, because I feel the character threads are all there. And when I was trying to talk it out with people are like, yeah, no, we get why she did it. I just didn't like it when you made me read it. So it is earning the tension rather than earning the character, I think. Yeah.
And mostly I just wanted to bring it up just because I thought it was a very, I just thought it was very interesting and like a cool thing to talk about, is like when a scene isn't quite landing, what are the things that's not there? It's a good exercise to think about. So I wanted to bring it back just for listeners and stuff around like character driven things being deserved in the plot versus tension or tone things being deserved in the plot is a good distinction to make.
Mm-hmm.
It's cool.
I'll ask you all a question. We talked, a lot of this horror stuff is new to me, and the idea of the warning, like, it makes total sense and I've seen it, but I hadn't ever thought about it or realized it. Why is the warning so crux to horror? I mean, it almost sounds like an element of like a morality tale. And horror, I think, has a lot to do with morality tales, you know, like characters ignore the warning and there's a transgression and this is what happens to you if you ignore the transgression.
Is that it?
There's something innately like the bad thing happens because the characters deserve it because they ignored the warning.
There's two elements to it. And one of them is, like you said, the morality and the kind of tragedy of it, that the character is almost self-inflicted this upon themselves. Well, the far more basic reason for it is that the reader needs to know that there is a monster before the monster appears, basically. So that is kind of bringing me on to my next point, which is once you've given the warning and your hero has decided to go ahead anyway, what happens next? You can't just have the monster walk out of the shadows and eat the character, because then the story is over. So what you do is you have a nice long stretch of story where you put your character through some real trouble before they meet the monster or the final horror or like the scenario or whatever it is you've made your end point. But the trick is to then kind of terrorize your character throughout this. And you can't always terrorize your character with your end scare or with your monster, because you can only use it once for effect. And after that, the fear of it is really dissipated. It becomes a known quantity and you lose that element of the unknown that makes it so scary. So this is why your warning is so important, because your warning is setting up that that is something there. Maybe not specifically saying what the monster is or what it is, but being vague enough to let the audience know that there's something bad. And then your character is starting on the journey of being terrorized by the monster. But as I said, it's complicated and you can't necessarily just have the monster knock on the door and step right into the scene. So what you have to use is a technique called hiding the monster. And people often think of it. Yeah. People often think of this as various techniques of keeping the monster off the page or off the screen. But what it actually is finding different ways of deriving horror from the monster or even from the environment without actively having the monster on display. Kind of a basic one of these is like hints or evidence of the monster, like having the monster howl or having the monster like make noises in the other room, maybe having the characters go into the room to see, oh, was that weird noise? And seeing evidence of something having happened or something, someone having been there that maybe shouldn't have been there. Various things like this. This is where I feel like horror writers are kind of making their bread and butter, because they can't always have the monster be the thing that comes in and wrecks everybody. They have to kind of have these little hints of dread and have these little hints of elements as the story goes along. There's a few, that's kind of the, some of the more basic ones are hints and evidence, but you also have something called cues, which is my absolute favorite because it's one of the most potent. The cues can often be derived from even the limitations of your monster. For example, if your monster only comes out at night, you now have dusk as a cue for horror. And you have scenes that are taking place at night as scenes where potentially the monster could come in. So you need to be aware of that when you're telling your story. If you want to have a moment of levity, you shouldn't have it at night if that's when the monster can come along. It'll work much better during the day. And then your scenes at night, you should be conscious that the dread is present in those scenes. Also, if you're trying to have surprises, it's not going to be as big a surprise if the monster bursts into the room at night when you know the monster can burst into the room. Then if the characters are walking around during the day and then accidentally find themselves somewhere that's super dark, the monster doesn't necessarily have to be there, but that scene will carry a lot of dread because the reader will feel like they've made a massive mistake. Things like werewolves appearing at a full moon, that's another cue. Because you have the month is coming towards an end, you know that the monster is going to come back in and that starts building a sense of dread. Things like the clock striking midnight 3 times in a row before the ghost comes out and does its scary thing. That clock then becomes a cue about which a writer can create a lot of dread and a lot of suspense. You can just have the character sitting there in the dark by themselves, waiting for the clock to strike. You don't even have to have the ghost appear. You don't have to have the shelves running in and out. It's just the buildup to the clock striking. So cues are a really, really effective way of creating horror, and they often work best. That's why limitations of a monster can be so effective, because it is that thing that allows the monster to appear at this time and not appear at that time. Films where the monster is in the water, that means the scenes that are outside of the water is where all the levity and that's where everyone catches their breath, and now the characters are near the water and that's where the dread comes back in. And of course, this is a limitation of the monster, which should make it less scary, but it actually works to make it more scary by having those scenes take place in that way. Then you've also got stories, which is just people explaining stuff about the monster. Jaws, for example, had a scientist who knew about sharks and was telling all these stories about the sharks. Same with Dan Simon's The Terror. One character is an expert on polar bears and is telling about how scary the polar bears are, and that kind of builds up the fear of that. That's quite a basic one, but can be used really, really effectively in a horror story. And then one of my favorite ones is speculation and imagination, which is kind of like what I was saying to Ali. One of my all-time favorite horror stories is called The Willows by Algernon Blakewood, which is about two guys who are on a rowing trip and they spend a night on a small island full of willows. And throughout the story, there are these long passages where a character is just staring into the trees, imagining all of this kind of like crazy stuff happening. But then being like, oh, I really let my imagination run away with me. But all of these imaginings are really concise and they kind of feed into this overall idea of what is happening. So the writer manages to maintain an element of like, it's just trees, but also he's telling this overall complicated narrative of like what's going on. So speculation and imagination can be really useful if perhaps you have a really complex monster or really maybe a really complex scenario and you kind of need the reader to understand it, but you can't necessarily have the character to be consciously aware of it the whole time. So you have the character maybe imagine terrible things that are happening. But if he's imagining terrible things happening with kind of a concise cause for each of them, and that concise cause is the actual horror, what you've done is communicated to the reader what your monster is without actually having your monster on show, if you know what I mean.
H.P. Lovecraft does a lot of imagining and speculation for the setup of his stories, which I really like, or some of the ones that really stood out are where he first, like for the first paragraph, he's just like talking straight to the reader. He's basically saying like, right now, currently existing on the planet, just as you're existing right now, exists another place that's really old that currently nobody is in. And can you even imagine the things that take place in the deep, sweaty forests that nobody's currently inhabiting or nobody currently has eyes on, blah, 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 blah. Like these hidden places, let's bring the mind there and let's just imagine. And then that's your setup. And then you're in the story. Now let's go there.
He was really inspired by Algernon Blakewood. And I think specifically that story, The Willows, when you read that, you're like, oh, I see an awful lot of like cosmic horror and what would have inspired that in The Willows. Yeah, it's worth checking out.
Fantastic.
Algernon Blakewood.
Yeah, that just sounds like a horror
Algernon
writer.
Yeah,
he didn't want to write horror. But he was like, I guess I have to now.
With a name like that.
Thanks, Mom. Oh,
I'm treating this like a workshop, James. I'm just sitting here taking notes. It's fantastic. I'm going to ask you, like you're an expert on it. I've also struggled with a character like feeling really active in a horror, since inherently there's a lot of situations where things happen to a protagonist in horror. Mm-hmm. And I kind of clicked to when you said they intentionally decide to ignore the warning. Like that's a really active step and will already solve some of the things I'm thinking about in my own stories. But did you have any other tips and tricks or examples of ways that like protagonists stay active despite a lot of the world happening to them?
Yeah, I feel like the element of a horror story is almost like a cautionary tale. And like the reader is told that the character has wandered off the path. And that's almost up to the character to figure out what they've done wrong or figure out their way back onto the path. So if you kind of try to hold that idea in your mind in regards to keeping the character active, and I suppose it's almost like just a reversal of the hero's journey. You want to kind of keep making the character make mistakes and not quite fully figure out what it is the monster is or what it is the scenario they're in, depending on whether or not you want to have them get away in the end or not. You have them figure it out and then beat the monster and then get home, or you have them kind of fail to figure it out, but maybe the reader figures it out, or maybe they figure it out, but it's too late for them to do anything about it. I know H.P. Lovecraft often talked about the horror story as a transgression, that the character has transgressed and they either try to get away with their transgression, or yeah, like walk back or ignore the consequences, but eventually they're brought to a point where they have to acknowledge that they've made the transgression and then try and fix it. but it may at that point be too late for them, or they may be stopped by the monster.
I was going to say, Ali, one way to do it is, I really like horror in which there's I really love survival horror. It's probably one of my favorite genres, because when we're talking about horror, it doesn't necessarily have to be this big imaginary creature that's going to try and kill you. I mean, that's great as well. I love that. But there can also just be this sort of thing of the situation they're in. Like a book that I just reread recently, which I was I know I was yelling at you guys to read a while ago, and I didn't really conceptualize it as survival horror, but it really is the Poseidon Adventure, where the premise is a ship, like a cruise ship, goes and it turns and it flips over onto its, turtles essentially. And then they kind of all have to climb up the top. But the idea of that is, and I'm getting back to your point on passivity, like the idea of that, the whole notion of that whole book is that like a bunch of the characters are going, look, we're here. Like it's fallen over. Maybe someone will come and rescue us. And there's this one character who is like not, you realize as you go on, he's not actually all there. Like there's something a little screwy about him. And that's revealed later in the story, what's going on. But he's like, no, what we have to do is we actually have to get as far up to the top as we can. And people are sort of arguing, and they're like, he's like, he initially frames it as, look, we need to get as close to the top of the ship as we can so that people are going to find us. But as it goes on, you realize it's less about that, and it's more just about this metaphysical struggle to ascend and just do something because you're going to die. So that passivity, I think, can be offset a bit by just the character's pure will to life and their sense of like, I just really want to get out of this situation. I'm going to try and do what I can to get to point Z, just to get out of this. So despite the fact that something's happening, if they're actively pushing against this, whatever it is, whatever, if it's running away from a monster or escaping a horrible situation, they've always got this, there's almost this laser focus of like, I'm just trying to do this one thing, which is get away from this. It seems like it's a negative thing, but it's actually a very like active choice to do something. So I don't know. I'd say that's probably a way to activate your characters, I guess. Does that make sense?
Yeah, no,
definitely.
I love that.
Yeah. I would also add in like 1984 as well, as a story that has an end state, which is really horrific. And then all of the hints of that are kind of the characters that are controlled and the characters who kind of get disappeared and stuff like that. But throughout that story, the main character is active in that he is making these tiny acts of rebellion against the society, and he's trying to just do his own little thing. And that makes him very active. But that is then also the transgression that he makes that gets himself put into the situation he gets put into.
And a lot of his active behavior is actually just internal struggle. It's not even necessarily him doing things in the world. It's his own, it's his thoughts, and it's his worries and his concerns, which is active in a different way, I guess.
All right. So the very, very last point I want to make, and I haven't made notes on this, so it's going to be a little bit messy, is ambiguity in a story. Like I was saying, you've set up your warning, you've given all the little hints about your monster, but you've kept it hidden. And now you have to have your big reveal of your monster at the end, which is kind of like delivering on the promise that you've made. This can be a tricky moment, because the scarier the story has been and the more you've built it up, the more pressure there is upon the delivery of your monster at the very end. Stephen King kind of famously usually flops this at the end of his stories, where he kind of like has made such a great journey and kind of falls short a little bit when he gives the delivery at the end. So one technique that actually allows you to kind of almost carry your tension on beyond the story is to have some kind of setup of ambiguity, where it may not be necessarily what everyone thought it was, and it might be something else altogether. This doesn't work for every story. One of my favorite horror stories, it's called The Terror by Dan Simmons, which is about a boat in like the 17th century, which gets landlocked by trapped in ice up in like the North Atlantic. And polar bears start trying to get into the boat. But while the characters are trapped, they all begin to speculate and worry about what it is that's outside, and sailor superstition. They're talking about devils, and they're talking about this thing called an auroch, which is a kind of, the inhabitants of that area believed in like ice monsters and stuff like this. And they actually have an awful lot of information about that in the story. So it has this twin ideas of, one, it's a polar bear trying to get in and eat everybody, or two, it's this kind of supernatural monster that's trying to get in. So the story exists in two places and manages to kind of walk this line in between the two, so that when it ends, you don't have the satisfaction of having realized which it was, and you're kind of like, oh wow, was it a monster or was it something else altogether? So that's a really useful thing. If you're feeling like that's the kind of story you want to tell, I think that's one of the strongest horror elements, is to have a kind of ambiguous monster that could be this or could be that. You can have that by maybe having the character be going a little bit crazy, or be having no one else have witnessed the events that the character is claimed to have witnessed. This manages to carry on that level of uncertainty on past the story. And I think it leaves the reader feeling pretty scared.
That's I'm like Ellie said, I'm loving a lot of this is new terminology. Like it's stuff, yeah, there are elements that I've been putting in stories, but I just never had names for them and never like itemized them as tools to officially like have like reference flashcards to like, I want to put a cue in here. Like they're great for focusing down points. Mm-hmm. But I was just thinking about this. I'm not sure if I talked about this in a previous podcast. I think I did, but I wrote like a really, really short horror, horror story that was maybe like 100 or 200 words, like really, really short flash fiction. And I was realizing that the end, the reveal, my horror reveal was a cue that I'd set up, and it was meant to leave on an ambiguous note, because it's a cue I set up with texture around like the dog having just been shaved and being completely bald, and that's set up. And at the very end, he's petting something as he's going delirious and going into uncontrollable sleep. He's petting something and commenting on how fluffy it is. And it's like, that's the cue of like, oh, that's not the dog. And then the cut to black, the character goes to sleep. Yeah. So I just brought that to mind, like ambiguity and cue endings. It's like,
yeah.
And maybe that's a good way to think of it. Like a great way to end ambiguously is to end on a cue, but maybe a stronger cue than you've given all along. It's like,
oh yeah, actually. Yeah. That is a good point.
Yeah.
I think the trick for if you're worrying, if you're landing in an ambiguous place or not, you just kind of ask, what are the two options, and ask, could they both be true in the way the story is told? And that neither of them contradicts the other, because if one of them contradicts the other, then that's the one that's true. So you just have to try to tell a story in a way where both of them are potentially what's happening.
So cool. I love that you've articulated that.
Mm-hmm. It's a masterclass.
And it also kind of, yeah, it is. It kind of occurs to me as well that you said it earlier, James, that almost more so than other genres, horrors do wind up with a moral or some kind of message. So I think it's Brandon Sanderson who says it, that I love, that he doesn't write stories to deliver answers. He just likes to raise questions. And I feel like most other genres exist in that space to just be a conversation about a topic, but there's no need to deliver on an answer. There's no need for an author to be didactic. But if horror wants to set up that transgression that they're universally punished for, the genre itself will always, it seems to inherently lean towards having a moral more so than other genres do. And especially you're talking about that ambiguity state. I messed up that word, but I'll stick with it. But if one is the metaphysical story, and then one is the polar bears are just trying to get on the boat, I like the idea that the metaphor story is also usually always going to be linked to some kind of moral outcome as well.
It was in that story as well. Yeah, just the way things played out. So yeah.
Yeah, no, I love that. This is just me speaking out loud, my epiphany as I'm having it.
Mm. Yeah, I think it is. Yeah, like it's definitely tied to like the cautionary tale, and then like the story of, like I said, the path, and then you don't go off the path and go over here and do this thing. And if you do, maybe you can figure it out and like make amends for it and come back. But then not always, if you're very stubborn, or if you're the thing that drew you out there in the first place, if you're like, oh, I'm so close to getting it, and they kind of stay in that place to try to get the thing that they want and then get out, then it's too late.
Hmm. It makes me interested in the psychology of horror writers now being, are they the kind of person who has stronger opinions about paths, mm-hmm. or are they the kind of person who is just inherently like, more fearful of stepping off paths and wants to explore what happens every time they step off a path.
I don't know. I won't put it down my life.
Yes, no. There's nothing healthy down that road trying to work out why we write what we write.
The hit film Cabin in the Woods, off of the whole like cautionary tales thing. At the end, basically they're saying the whole setup for these rituals is you need youth, you need naivety, and you need the archetypes of like basically like essentially sins. It's like you have the fool who's like overly naive or gluttonous, you have the person who's like I can't think of a better way to say it, but like the slut, the like one that's harlot, like the harlot, yeah. And like they're too caught up in the earthly like desires to recognize warning signs, and they get got because of that. And it's the whole commentary on that, but it is the whole cautionary thing. It basically plugs into the sins and the slap on the wrist because of it.
Yeah. So I think that's taken us up to about the 50 minute mark. So I'm just going to do a reading. This is from a short horror story I wrote called Last of Winter. And this scene was essentially the warning to my character that he was about to make a mistake. What's happening in the scene is the two characters are farmers. They live near a wood. Inside in the wood is a mysterious building. And wolves. They can hear wolves at night all the time. And one of the characters, his sheep has died, and they've decided to bury the sheep so that its body doesn't lure the wolves in out of the woods towards their farm. But the ground is just really frozen and hard. So I'll just jump in. Matt looked up towards the woods, a thing he always did now when his eyes did not need to be elsewhere. Over the dark angular pines aligned in rough rows like the spearheads of an amassed army, he saw a singular black streak of smoke pointing up to the grey canvas of sky. He knew from where within the gloomy wood it originated, but the tantalizing question that agitated his nerves and tickled the back of his throat was the question of what the odd inhabitants of the gatehouse were burning. An idea closed upon him then, one laughing with simplicity, given the futility of their current endeavor, but containing within it a seed of misfortune for both men that Matt could not, at this moment, foresee. Throwing down his pike, he turned to Kirk. Forget this. This will take us until nightfall to dig this grave, if we don't freeze before then. If we're so worried about the wolves coming for this, why not bring it to them? He pointed to the woods and the dark, unwavering pillar. You mean go up there? Mist obscured Kirk's face, but not the pale orbs of his eyes, widening in alarm. Why not? If the butchers won't take it, the wolves will, and the sentries will be glad of it. They must have to feed the animals from their own supply. A dark expression fell across Kirk's face. Nobody goes up that way, and nothing comes down either. Leave it that way. Leave it to the sentries. What are you talking about? I'm talking about I've been here on this farm for 5 years, and I've seen nothing in those woods resembling a wolf. But I hear things at night, as I'm sure you do too, that no godly animal casts out. That lot up there are a bad trope. They got something that's worse. Something that hunts at night, aye, and keeps the outsiders away. Ain't no wolf mind. Matt, to his credit, did not share in the superstitions of many of his fellow settlers and scoffed at this. Leave it alone, Kirk repeated. I dare say your predecessors would tell you the same, but they ain't here anymore now, are they? What do you mean by that? Kirk was silent for a moment, as if debating whether to go on. In the end, he let out a long, grave sigh and said, Graham Barrett claimed to have seen it once, said it spoke to him, said it wouldn't stop speaking to him. Then he was gone. Grave Barrett deserted, Matt said bitterly. Kirk shook his head soberly and nodded towards the woods. Up there, that's where it took him. Or else the sentries come down and brought him off quietly. Maybe that's what they do. Come and disappear people, what get to speak of the things they shouldn't. You go up there looking for it, and maybe they'll disappear you too, just for being curious. But then I might have some company and warmth for the winter. Matt took the ewe by the ankles. Will you help me with it? No chance in hell. You go up there and let it be on your head. It's your animal. I want to dispose of, and I made an offering. You make relations with those people and what they've got under the gatehouse, and it will never leave you. Folks don't ask questions when people run off from that farm of yours, and maybe they should. Maybe they find they didn't run off. Let it alone, Matthew. Draw that bloody thing in the river and be done with it. But Matthew wouldn't listen. He threw Kirk's dead sheep over his shoulder and left Kirk alone to his superstitious warnings. Kirk called after him through the rising wind. Don't go up there, Matt. None of us can help you if it follows you back down.
Ooh, I really like this story.
It's very good.
Thank you.
What was it like? Pin a thread of black smoke on the gray canvas sky or something? Yeah. Right from that line I was in, I was like, oh, I see it. Okay, I'm here.
But yeah, like, it was a lot of fun to write that story. I quite enjoyed it.
Rising tension.
Also, you read very well. Like, it's really nice to listen to you read, especially say probably in this genre, especially like, and it might just be your voice or something, or maybe how
accent.
Or as in like your, the way you wrote your character's dialogue was in a way where I was like, I don't think I could do that. Cause you had some, like the way you like threw in an I or like certain little like mannerisms of speech that like, they don't exist in my speech like at all. So I don't know if I would have, but they sounded so real. And I don't, that's like how you captured that.
All right, Alex, did you have a quote?
I did have a quote, yes. This is from one H.P. Lovecraft. And I think it pertains here. So he said, "The oldest and strongest emotion of mankind is fear. And the oldest and strongest kind of fear is fear of the unknown." Which is, I think, essentially the essence of horror.
Nice. All right. This has been the Pros and Cons Precipice Fiction Podcast. Thank you very much for listening. Goodbye.
Goodbye. Bye.
You're listening to Pros and Cons, the Precipice Fiction Podcast.